I cannot control what the reality is in front of all of us, but that's where the violence is happening. That's where the majority of the arrests are going to take place.
You can listen to the full interview at WGNradio.com. On the Senate floor today, Senator Durbin calling for Majority Leader Mitch McConnell to bring the Justice and Policing Act to the Senate for a vote immediately.
Hearings aren't enough. We need to do something the Senate rarely does anymore. Pass a law. How about that? We need legislation on this subject, not lamentation.
He says the bill ends chokeholds, no-knock warrants, and will require officers to have on-dashboard cameras and body cams. The Cook County Medical Examiner's Office today confirming a 9-month-old boy who died in March was due to COVID-19. Joseph Miles died of viral pneumonia and the coronavirus. He's the youngest victim to die in Cook County from the coronavirus. Dr. Anthony Fauci, the nation's top infectious disease expert, says it's possible a vaccine could be ready sooner than originally expected.
If we are in good shape and that happens, we could have a vaccine either by the end of this calendar year or in the first few months of 2021.
He spoke to ABC's Good Morning America this morning. In Illinois today, the Department of Public Health announcing 625 new cases and 78 additional deaths in the last 24 hours. The Federal Reserve is holding steady on interest rates, keeping them at zero or near zero until the economic damage done by the pandemic is over. It suggested it may do so through 2022. President Trump urged the Fed to go to negative interest rates, as some other countries have done. An off-duty Chicago police officer has died from what appears to be carbon monoxide poisoning. Officers Zhu Ming and a 29-year-old woman were found unresponsive in an Albany Park home on Tuesday. Some neighbors had to be evacuated nearby.
Second unit had a CO level almost half of what the first house had.
People's Gas says the carbon monoxide level in the home was extremely at dangerous levels. The woman remains in critical condition. A car was found running inside an attached garage. And now with WGN Neighborhood News, here's Pam Jones.
Navy Pier is now open. Parks around the pier, the main walkway, outdoor restaurants, and some free programs are underway. The Children's Museum's rides and the Shakespeare Theater remain closed. Parking at the pier garage will be free during the first reopening phase. It's not clear when boat rides will begin. I'm Pam Jones with Neighborhood News on 720 WGN.
WGN Sports, here's Andy Mazur.
Well, negotiations continue between Major League Baseball and the MLB Players Association in hopes of getting the 2020 season underway. The union countered the owner's offer of 76 games and 75% prorated with an 89-game schedule and full prorated pay. The players' proposal also includes a 16-team postseason in 2020 and in 2021. Now it's up to the owners to come up with something, and the holdup, of course, pay at this point, and time is running short on both sides to get the season going. Baseball's amateur draft will begin tonight with the first 37 picks. It's a greatly reduced draft down to just 5 rounds from the usual 40. The White Sox will pick at number 11. The Cubs select at number 16. Several Blackhawk players returned to the team's practice facility today and to begin skating. The workouts are voluntary and part of phase 2 of the NHL's return to play program. Among those skating today, Patrick Kane and Alex DeBrincat. The Hawks will be 12th in the Western Conference when the playoffs begin next month. And Major League Soccer announced that its season will resume July 8th, a tournament in Florida. The league's 26 teams will be divided into 6 groups for the opening round of the tournament, played without fans in Orlando. On the home of the Blackhawks, Northwestern Wildcats, and White Sox baseball, Andy Mazur, WGN Sports.
Your money on WGN, sponsored by T-Mobile for Business. Visit T-MobileForBusiness.com. The Dow closed down 282 points today. NASDAQ up 66. The S&P 500 down 17 points. I'm Kim Gordon on Chicago's very own 720 WGN.
T-Mobile and Sprint are joining forces to build a network that will cover more offices and employees across the country. You'll get the largest and most reliable network at an unbeatable price. Visit T-MobileForBusiness.com to learn more.
And they're off. Out of the gate, it's summer's here, followed by biting mosquitoes, ticks aplenty, and yard pests galore. But wait, here comes Mosquito Squad at the turn, blowing away the competition, absolutely killing biting mosquitoes, ticks aplenty, and yard pests galore. These three are nowhere to be seen. It's summer's here, and Mosquito Squad pulling away, coming into the final stretch. It's gonna be close. It's summer's here with Mosquito Squad at your place. Summer's here and Mosquito Squad, a winning combination. Go to MosquitoSquadChicago.com. That's MosquitoSquadChicago.com.
Is COVID-19 causing concerns about getting medical care when you need it? With telehealth, it's easy to safely connect with experts at North Shore University Health System. Telehealth and e-visits offer care online or on the phone without leaving home. from primary care to consulting with a specialist for serious issues. And for in-person visits, we're practicing the latest safety protocols. Get the care you need now at North Shore, online, on the phone, or in person. Visit northshore.org/telehealth.
MegaPros proudly remains available for any help you need in or around your home. Yes, we can help in anything you might need. Even if it's just a question, your pros are here to help. It's MegaPros pleasure. You know you can depend on that.
I suppose that's us. Is it not us? That is us. We missed a little. Our introductory music. That's very sad for me when that happens. All right, let's get right into it, though, because we have a lot to deal with today. Some of it fun. I'm trying to go to the fun after five, but wait till you hear what happens. It's going to be something. Want to start with Lori Lightfoot today. I normally do this in the 5 o'clock hour where we talk about the press conferences that happen during the day. We're no longer carrying those. Nobody's carrying those live so much anymore. But we know that there's important stuff that happens. And so we want to bring some of them to you. So the mayor had a press conference today, and she was asked questions directly about that leaked audio tape that we played for you a couple of days ago, where she and Alderman Lopez got into it on a phone call that they had on the Sunday night of the of all the crazy looting on the 31st of May. There was a conference call with the all 50 aldermen, her and some other people. And she was asked what she thought of this. Now, if you missed the interaction that the two of them had, I would like to replay that for you. So you have a sense of it. We're having trouble getting that particular piece of audio. Is that what I'm just being told by the control room? Okay. All right. We've lost our audio feed. That is my problem. All right. So let me know when that comes back up, so we don't get any of the hate to produce this on the air, but there is we're not getting any of the audio feedback from him. Stand by, please. I want everybody just this is where
we need Kevin.
Yes,
classic
where Kevin goes.
Technical difficulties. Oh, I'm not as good at saying it.
No, you're not. And I'm going to guess Andy really is neat. I don't think Andy
I wish I had practice, yeah. I don't know.
Classic technical difficulties.
Please stand by.
While we do this, I will tell you what else is coming up on the program. You know, my best efforts have been thwarted here just to get right into it. You know, they're like, no, meander, just get right into it. Okay, well, I'm just trying to get right into it now. I can't get right into it. Anyway, we will play that tape for you in just a second. I want to tell you this, so coming up on the program, we are going to talk to a doctor also this hour from Northwestern dealing with coronavirus fatigue. This is a really interesting thing. We've been talking about it for the last week or so, where people are like, I just don't care about this anymore. And I just want to go out and live my life. It seems like everybody else is okay. I don't think I really have a problem. I don't think anybody else I know has had a problem. So if they've gotten it, they've gotten sick, they've gotten better, and I'm just going to move on with my life, which I think a lot of people feel, right? But how do you do that? How do you move on with your life and still be safe about it? And still be safe not only for you, but also for the rest of your family. Because I think the horse is out of the barn. I don't think we're going to turn back around and everybody run back into their homes. Nobody wants to do that. But if you do want to go live a fairly normal life, we will give you some guidance on how that is best done. Plus, this doctor will also explain to us the WHO's very confusing guidance about asymptomatic spread. What the hell does that mean? So, and we'll take your phone calls too with the doctor from Northwestern. That's coming your way after the bottom of the hour news. And also on the program today, would you like to go camping this summer? You know, you hear these people that are getting like RVs, not necessarily like camping in a campground, but they want to have their own hotel room, bathroom, bed, and all that. How's that working? Because, you know, the RV industry stopped renting RVs years ago. They just wanted people to buy them, and then maybe you could rent it from somebody who'd bought it, but this was not the initial idea of to just sell them into rental agencies. Well, they're going back to it now because of COVID-19, and it's really interesting. So this might be a possibility for your summer vacation. We will explain that in the 5 o'clock hour. Okay. So what I'm going to do here is we're going to see if we can get this all fixed. All we have to actually get the. What happened to my hamster? We're going to get the hamster. We're going to put it on the treadmill, and we're going to see if we can actually work this out. But first, let's do this. Lauren, give us the WGN traffic.
Will do. There's a crash inbound on the Eisenhower blocking three right lanes at Paulina. Right now, traffic is solid from Western. Also seeing an accident involving three vehicles in the loop. That's impacting traffic at Randolph and State. And on the southwest side, there's a downed tree on Avers near 47th. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
Enter for a chance to win $150 in groceries from Jewel, Grainberry cereal, and a pack of face coverings from Boomer Naturals in the Triple Play Grocery Giveaway, sponsored by Grainberry and Boomer Naturals. Details at WGNradio.com/contests.
Every day brings an opportunity to connect to your community and one another. With AARP, you can connect without ever leaving home. Just click, and you're at a movie watch party with other fans, viewing a webinar on how to virtually care for loved ones, or listening to a fraud prevention podcast. Connections like these remind us that we're all in this together. With virtual offerings available here in Chicago, you can click to connect at aarp.org/near you.
At Amida Health, they believe there's no one quite like you. So they offer care focused on your needs with individualized treatment plans and doctors and nurses who embrace you like family. With hundreds of locations and online scheduling, accessing their compassionate care is easy and convenient. Learn more at amidahealth.org/access. To find a doctor, call 855-MY-AMIDA. Amida Health, in sickness and in health.
Hey guys, don't mind me as I interrupt your radio program. It's Sue Cosner, sexual health expert, on men's performance in the bedroom. Do me a favor and don't touch that dial. That's a mistake. If you've been listening to this radio station, you've probably heard a compelling radio ad for Noxetril, the potent all-natural male enhancement pill. Men constantly reach out and ask me, does this Noxetril really work? Or is it just another scam product? I can tell you there's nothing better than Noxetril. I recommend this super pill to men everywhere. It will transform your life in the bedroom once and for all. Strong, powerful results that increase your blood flow fast. No prescription, no side effects. Just imagine Viagra on steroids. So call Noxetril now and take advantage of an incredible free bottle offer shipped discreetly to your door.
Call right now and get your free supply. Call 800-480-8329. That's 800-480-8329. It's like Viagra on steroids. Improve your sex life with your free supply. Call 800-480-8329. That's 1-800-480-8329.
Early morning, stay safe and stay connected with Morgan Kochmeyer's weather forecast and Sharon Gendra's traffic reports. Weekdays 4 to 6 on WGN-TV Morning News.
You know, before we do that, we're getting through our technical difficulties here at the very top of the show. We're going to get this all figured out, though. Don't you worry about it. That's one of the fun things about with all the broadcast companies having people work from home. It's an adventure every day. Let me tell you this before we move on here. Need new windows or doors? Call the company recommended by Lou Manfredini. Call Gilkey Windows. Gilkey manufactures the highest quality vinyl and fiberglass windows in an endless variety of styles and colors. Right now, take $1,000 off five or more windows, $2,500 off 10 or more windows, and take $700 off patio and entry doors, or no money down, no interest for 12 months. Visit their showrooms in Chicago Ridge Monday through Saturday or Palatine all week, including Sunday, 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. Visit Gilkey.com or call 888-3-GILKEY. That's 888-3-GILKEY. All right. Now we believe we are back to some level of normalcy here. He said almost laughingly, but I'm feeling like we might be able to get this done. Okay, so I want to play some audio for you from today. Lori Lightfoot reacted to what has now become a bit of a controversy. She got into a yelling match on a conference call with aldermen a week ago Sunday, the 31st of May, during a conversation about the looting and all the other stuff that was going on. She wanted to talk to all the aldermen, and there was some crazy interchange between the two of them. This is Alderman Ray Lopez describing the situation in his neighborhood.
Right now, Mayor, back in the yard in Brighton Park, from Halsted almost all the way through to Kedzie, along 47th Street, has been a virtual war zone. Ashland Avenue, which borders between me and Alderman Taylor, has had 400 people and four lanes of traffic almost for an hour. And we can't expect our police, and I don't fault them at all, to be able to control this.
Okay. Well, this seems all right, right? But then?
What are we going to do, and what do we tell our residents other than good faith people stand up? It's not going to be enough.
Thank you, Alderman. Next question.
Well, no, I want an answer. You commented on everybody. I want an answer. It's not something you ignore. This is a question that I have.
I think you're 100% full of shit, is what I think. If you think we
no offense, to you then.
Hold on.
Okay. Okay, well, and it just kind of went on from there. There was like an FU and a this and a that, and it was just ugly. So the mayor was asked about this in her press conference today. Well, now that that's been released, and again, it only got released, you know, within the last 36 hours. So this is the first opportunity for anybody to ask her about this. And so she was asked about it, and I think this is a rather curious answer.
First of all, if you heard the entirety of the conversation, it was, I believe, on a Sunday night, the conversation that went for an hour and a half. And unfortunately, one of the aldermen, and I think we know who it is, illegally taped and then shared only that portion of the conversation that served his purposes. What I'll say is this: these are tough and difficult times, and we ought to be able to have candid conversations.
Uh-huh. Okay. Well, I agree. The site that she said afterwards, yes, these are tough and difficult times. We must have candid conversations. She's agree. She's right. I don't think that's an illegal recording of that, though, because that is, I think there is the courts would probably find that since it's over electronic devices, it's a semi-public hearing between all of those folks. I don't think that would, and it's a government hearing. It's a government agency, not in a top secret form. I don't think it's illegally taped. But hey, am I a lawyer? No, I'm not a lawyer. But I just don't like that answer because it seems like she's trying to go back on him about this when really the issue is not being dealt with at all. But then she goes and doubles down. Here you go.
There were a lot of incredible emotions that were shared on that call by fellow aldermen, now all of whom don't feel secure or safe coming together with their colleagues because of one individual who decided to illegally tape a conversation that was intended to be a private conversation among all of us. Shame on him. Shame on him. That's what I say.
Isn't that helping? Because what he talked about, do we have the part where I almost afraid to ask for this because we had so many technical difficulties, but that alderman talked about what was going on in his neighborhood. Right. He was talking about people who were willing to, you know, pull out automatic weapons and go to battle instead of waiting for the police.
What happens when they start going after residents, going into the neighborhoods? Once they start trying to break down people's doors so they think they got something, or, you know, we know that people are here to antagonize and incite, and you've got them all pumped tonight. Today, they're not going to go to bed at 8:00. They're going to turn their focus in the neighborhood. I've got gangbangers with AK-47s walking around right now, just waiting to settle some scores.
Yes. Now, that is really true. And that was really happening. We have the audio of that. We played the audio of that a number of times over a number of days of guys from that neighborhood who went on YouTube to try to threaten people who were going to be coming into their neighborhood who they didn't think should be in their neighborhood, and they had automatic weapons. And then in the middle of the taping of a YouTube video, live gunfire broke out. And we know that was all true. We know what was going on there. The city was lost for those essentially 48 hours on the 30th and 31st of May. And I understand there's a lot of recrimination, but it is not time to go back to the weekend and point fingers and say, this guy did this, or that was illegally taped, or this didn't happen, because we know what happened. The city got lost for that moment. Chicago police, despite, I believe, their best efforts, lost parts of downtown Chicago on Saturday that they did not anticipate that they would ever, ever, ever lose. I talked off the record with a police commander yesterday, mentioned this yesterday, in which there was on Monday, I should say, in which he talked openly about the fact that the Chicago Police Department was very proud of a record of never having lost control of downtown, despite whatever happened. In 1968, they did not lose control of downtown. Didn't go well in 68, and it took the Chicago Police Department generations to recover from some of those images. But they never lost downtown. They lost downtown on Saturday night, May 30th, 2020. And they are angry about it. And it's not to say that the people who, this is not like protesters taking a knee or protesters marching and being loud and boisterous, but legal in terms of their protest. These are people who are coming down, some of them professional looting crews from outside the city of Chicago, coming from other cities that were here to take advantage of what was going to be this weekend unrest. And they know that. They know, the police know it, and the mayor knows it, and state officials know it. They understand exactly what happened. And it got lost because there was just not enough coordination. And I get, and listen, no one is as frustrated by all of what we're seeing here as, you know, as I am. I'm sure you are as well. I am sure you are as well. Because you see the pictures of George Floyd. You see those images. You watch that entire videotape, which, you know, you watch at your own peril because it is absolutely heartbreaking in a way. And it does not matter that George Floyd had a criminal past. It does not matter that George Floyd, you know, had fentanyl in his system. None of that matters ultimately. I know there's some of you who might be saying, oh, yeah, no, that matters. It doesn't matter once he's handcuffed. Once he's handcuffed and he's prone, he's on his stomach, and he's on the ground and he's not moving, you cannot knock him out by putting your knee on his neck. That's just not good policing. And there's not a single police official. There are probably zero good police officers who would argue that that is a way of handling that situation. It is not. And that led to a moment and we're going to talk about this a little bit later on in the program. It's kind of fascinating. That led to a moment in the midst of everything else, in the context of the pandemic, which we're going to tie together coming up in the 4 o'clock hour. I think you'd be fascinated by the conversation that we're going to have there, because this harkens back to another moment in Chicago history in which there was great unrest in the city that was also in the light of a pandemic. The last great pandemic, 101 years ago. But this all started to blow up here. And what we need is steady leadership. Luckily, the mayor did put a former police commander back in, brought him back in from the private sector to take over the response. We've had a pretty good run here for the last week or so, I would say. The city is starting to open back up. The interior parks are opening up. I think the lakefront is going to be soon to open up. And this all is going to happen in fairly short order. In order to maintain this, we need to maintain peace and prosperity in the city of Chicago. As we come back from the first problem, the COVID-19, we're going to need people to be coordinated and get along and show true leadership and not be sniping at each other. And I cannot tell you how disappointed I am. I am sure you are as well to hear. And even if you live in the suburbs or you live just in the metropolitan area, maybe you live over in Michigan and you're listening to this, Chicago is an important city in your life, no matter how you look at it. And you need Chicago to be prosperous and you need Chicago to be relatively safe. Bob Surratt had an amazing interview this morning with the head of the Fraternal Order of Police. I'm going to play a little bit of that a little bit later on in the program as well. And the Fraternal Order of Police chief here, newly elected, is, and again, that's a union position. He's not a city official. Talked about why there are so many African Americans arrested in the city of Chicago. And he also talked about the issue of of police officers taking a knee while they are in uniform. And I'll play that for you. And there was other questions as a result of what he said today to Bob Surratt in a press conference later today. And I'll be honest, I don't think this helps either. This is on behalf of people of goodwill who want to see this city get back up on its feet. And not just from the riots and the looting and all the rest of the stuff that happened here, because that was bad. But glass can be replaced. Businesses can come back. But if there is a sense that this city is lawless and out of control, the money will leave the city. Residents will leave the city. Taxpayers will leave the city. Businesses will leave the city. And we can't allow that to happen. So it is time, I would respectfully say, to the mayor, who I thought was doing a fairly good job with all of this, very difficult. I mean, with the exception of what happened on Saturday and Sunday, the 30th and 31st of May, the city's response has been pretty tight. But it was lost, and we have to go back and look at exactly what happened there so that that never, ever happens again. And you do, I mean, you can't blame the new superintendent. He'd just been on the job for a week when that happened. But there, I think that was also part of the transition of power. There were changes at the very top of the Chicago Police Department at that moment. So I think there were a lot of guys in white shirts with brass on their collars looking at each other going, who's responsible for this? Is this your job or my job or whatever it was? Not in a bad way. Not saying, hey, you handle it, because I know for a fact that's not what was being said. But I think that there was some communication and coordination issues on that night. And that can all be looked at in the long run. What I'm saying is we got to look at where we are right now, Your Honor, and Alderman, all 50 of you. And remember, at least 10 of you will go to jail in the next 10 years. I'm just saying that right now. So check yourself, put yourself together. This is a very important city, and this is our city, and I'm not going to let you screw it up. And Bob didn't let anybody screw it up this morning either, because I want to play some of that tape a little bit later on. That's what we're here for. Kim Gordon is in the WGN Northwestern Medicine Newsroom.
78 degrees at 3:30. Good afternoon. I'm Kim Gordon. The news is sponsored by Team Hochberg. Senator Durbin calling for the Justice and Policing Act to be passed immediately.
Hockey is back on the west side, at least sort of, as the Hawks begin phase two of the NHL restart plan.
And in business, Chicago-based United has a new requirement for passengers. WGN traffic, here's Lauren Lapka.
Inbound Kennedy is backed up from Fullerton. Right now it's 27 minutes from O'Hare and 22 back out. A disabled vehicle inbound on the Eisenhower is in the left lane near North Avenue. It's 35 minutes from 390 and 32 on the outbound side. Up on Stevenson, just a half hour to Veterans Memorial. No issues at all inbound. Both sides of the Dan Ryan between 95th and downtown are 15 minutes. On I-65 North, the entrance ramp at 109th is closed for road work until June 16th, and there's now a protest forming in Naperville near Webster and Jefferson. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
The news is next, but first, Tom Skilling's forecast from the Permaseal Weather Center. Tonight, a 30% chance for evening showers or storms. Clouds decrease overnight, a low of 58. Tomorrow, mostly sunny, breezy, a high of 81. Friday, sunshine with a high of 71. Illinois Senator Dick Durbin joining Senators Kamala Harris and Cory Booker in sponsoring the Justice and Policing Act. He's calling on Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell to bring the bill to the Senate for an immediate vote. He explains what changes will come about if the bill is passed.
The Justice and Policing Act also requires the use of dashboard cameras and body cameras for federal officers, state and local law enforcement. Our bill establishes a national police misconduct registry to prevent officers who've engaged in misconduct from simply moving to another department without accountability.
The bill also bans chokeholds and no-knock warrants. The Hennepin County Prosecutor's Office says former Minneapolis police officer Derek Chauvin was negotiating a plea deal before he was charged with second-degree murder. WGN's Ryan Burrow has more.
The prosecutor's office telling ABC News Derek Chauvin was planning to plead guilty to a local murder charge as part of a plea deal before ultimately being charged with second-degree murder. The office says such negotiations in high-profile cases aren't unusual, nor is the fact that a deal wasn't reached. Still unclear why the deal fell apart.
Meantime, Minneapolis Mayor Jacob Frey says he's not on board with abolishing the city's police department altogether following the death of George Floyd. This comes after Police Chief Madeira Arredondo announced he's withdrawing from contract negotiations with the city's police union in an effort to rebuild the department. United Airlines will now ask you to do a health assessment before you fly.
United says it's the first major U.S. airline that will have passengers complete a health checklist before they can get their boarding pass. Passengers will be asked if they've had any symptoms of COVID-19. They'll be asked if they've been around anybody with coronavirus, and they'll have to agree they'll wear a mask while on board. Passengers will have to accept the checklist affirming they're healthy to fly before getting a boarding pass. Alex Stone, EBC News.
Mayor Lightfoot announcing today a new $5 million cash assistance plan to cut $1,000 checks to 300,000 Chicagoans who did not qualify for federal stimulus money. Most of them are not in the country legally.
And we're able to do this because of the passion and foresight of our city partners who saw a problem and stepped up in a big way to creating a solution.
The Chicago Resiliency Fund was created by the Resurrection Project and Open Society Foundations through private donations. One of Chicago's iconic landmarks reopened today. Restaurants, outdoor vendors, and some boats are now operating at Navy Pier. Spokesperson Payal Patel says everyone must wear a mask and they're monitoring the number of people visiting.
We also have social distancing ambassadors in place. Those are our employees who will be circulating the pier, making sure people are physical distancing.
Other rides, including the Ferris wheel, remain closed, as well as the Children's Museum and the Shakespeare Theater. The Shedd Aquarium is the latest Chicago institution to make job cuts. The aquarium announced today 36 positions will be eliminated and 171 positions will be furloughed until the Shedd can reopen again to the public. And now WGN Sports, here's Andy Mazur.
Patrick Kane, among several Blackhawks players seen heading into the MB Ice Arena today, working out voluntarily. Alex DeBrincat, Alex Nylander was also seen going into the building. The Hawks facility officially able to open yesterday as part of phase two of the NHL's return to play plan. The Blackhawks will be the 12th seed in the Western Conference when the playoffs begin next month. The Baseball Players Union countered the owner's proposal today with an 89-game schedule and full prorated play throughout. They did agree that the owners, with the postseason being as many as 16 teams for this year and next season. This after the owners offering a 76-game season with 75% prorated pay. Reportedly also, the MLBPA's proposal includes $5 million in funds to assist minor leaguers and charitable organizations focused on social justice initiatives. Baseball's amateur draft will take place tonight. First 37 picks will be on the docket here. It's a greatly reduced draft down to just five rounds from the usual 40. The White Sox will have the 11th selection, and the Cubs will pick at number 16. Roger Federer will miss whatever remains of the coronavirus-impacted 2020 tennis season because of a setback in his recovery from knee surgery. It was his right knee. The 20-time Grand Slam champion had arthroscopic surgery in February and said he had to have a second procedure that will delay his return until 2021. On the home of the Blackhawks, Northwestern Wildcats, and White Sox baseball, Andy Mazur, WGN Sports.
Your money on WGN. The Dow closed down 282 points. NASDAQ up 66. The S&P 500 down 17. Gold up today. Oil up 2 cents at $38.96. And the VIX at the CBOE unchanged. I'm Kim Gordon on Chicago's very own 720 WGN.
Hi, this is Lou Manfredini, and I have John Rogers on the line, the president of Rogers Roofing, your trusted roofing contractor for over 50 years. John, the health and safety of homeowners and your employees is always your top priority. What is Rogers Roofing doing during these challenging times?
Lou, like most of us, we're monitoring the health concerns facing our communities. We've taken numerous actions to do our part in helping limit the spread of the virus while still providing homeowners the exceptional products and services they've come to expect. We are essential and we are working.
So if someone has damage or is in need of a new roof or new siding, is this a good time to call Rogers Roofing?
Absolutely. We'll provide you a virtual estimate in the comfort of your own home. And our production team is following the enhanced health precaution guidelines from the CDC and practice social distancing. Plus, we're providing our very best pricing and financing ever. I want to help our customers during these trying times and keep our employees working.
Call Rogers Roofing for a free virtual estimate. 800-NEW-ROOF. That's 800-NEW-ROOF. New roof, or log on to RogersRoofing.com.
Pro Conn Show, 720 WGN. All right, we're going to change gears here for just a moment, going back to the other story that has dominated 2020, and that is the COVID-19 outbreak. And we have now with us a doctor, thank God. Dr. Michael Bauer, Medical Director at Northwestern Medicine Lake Forest Hospital. And Doctor, thank you so much for being with us. And I want to talk to you about COVID fatigue, because that is a term we keep hearing now far more than we did a couple of weeks ago, that this is one of the reasons that people are just trying to get out. In the Chicago metropolitan area, where we've been under, in the state of Illinois, where we've been basically under the a lockdown of you know, of varying degrees, but a lockdown of any degree since the middle of March, people are tiring of this. And one of the problems, Doctor, is that we're not exactly sure, because every day when we turn on a television or look on our phones or look at the internet, we get a different answer about what things mean. For example, this whole issue about asymptomatic super spreaders, that the World Health Organization said, well, that's really not the case. Then the next day it said that really is the case. Can you first start by clearing that up?
Sure, Ro. Thanks for having me on. You know, I want people to remember that we've been at this COVID-19 situation here in the U.S. for just hitting 3 months now. It was really the second week in March that things started becoming on my schedule, talking about how are we going to handle this. So we're now only 3 months into this. That what we do know is that we are still learning a lot, a tremendous amount about this virus. But in relationship to the asymptomatic spread, we know there is a level of spread by people who are positive and don't have symptoms. We do know that, and that tends to occur about 2 to 3 days before those that are going to get sick actually start to experience their symptoms. So there's two areas you look at. One are asymptomatic people, which means I never got sick. I never had any symptoms. I had no clue that I had this virus, versus the pre-symptomatic stage, which is I'm feeling fine for a couple days, but able to pass and spread the virus before I get sick. Everybody knows about chickenpox. If you look at chickenpox, it has approximately an 85% infectivity rate for people. But the reason it was so contagious is they would spread it for 2 days before they ever got sick and broke out with their spots. When the WHO came out with this statement that it's rare, I think part was a poor communication and also lack of understanding by people. We have not done a lot of studies on asymptomatic people right now, in part because there was a shortage of testing supplies. Everybody know we had enough problems testing those that were sick or needed testing, let alone starting to do the studies on truly asymptomatic people and looking at how many people in the population may be carrying this. And what we have come to find, though, is that there definitely is a proportion of these patients that do have the ability to spread the virus that don't have any symptoms.
Now, does that mean that those are super spreaders because they don't know that they're sick and they're moving around among a bunch of other people? I think that's the question, and that's where the WHO guidance was so confusing, because, as you're saying, not a lot of study on this, but we do know that they are potentially contagious. So is it just an assumption that they are super spreaders?
Well, I don't know that they're technically a super spreader. It depends how many people they come in contact with while they are unmasked and the person that they are with is unmasked, and that they are in close physical proximity, so less than 6 feet, and generally more so in an indoor space. There is definitely less contagiousness outdoors. It can be spread, but being outdoors where the air circulates better can help reduce the rate of spread.
And we look as at some, people Doctor, hold on a second, because I want to get to this. This is really the big question is, what do we know now, months later, months into this, about how it has spread versus what we thought we knew before? And people outside now in Chicago, we're all going outside because the weather's been fairly good here. As you go out and you take a walk on your street, on your block, in a park, wherever you happen to be, or now that the restaurants are open, you're outside a little bit, what should be the appropriate distance? If you're walking past someone and you're both going in your own in different directions, is that dangerous?
No, that is not dangerous. We actually, the current definition of a potential contact or spread is 15 minutes while both people are unmasked and less than 6 feet. So walking by somebody randomly on the street, even if you're both unmasked, and unless you have the unfortunate experience where they coughed or sneezed directly on you or in your face, the likelihood of catching that from somebody, even if they were an asymptomatic shedder, is extremely, extremely slim.
Okay.
So people should be outside without masks. That if you're walking with somebody right next to each other, hand in hand, there is, if that's for a prolonged period of time, there is the potential, but it is really thought to be pretty low risk. What we do know is that primary spread is respiratory droplet. And that's different than an aerosol, which an aerosol, think of like, ooh, somebody's smoking ahead of me, mm-hmm. and then I walk in that puff of smoke. Yeah. That's an aerosol. Respiratory droplets fall to the ground pretty quickly. So
aerosol, because I wonder that all the time. I'm glad you brought that up, Doctor, because I will walk by people who are smoking. My favorite thing is to see somebody in a mask smoking, right? Or they drop the mask and then they're smoking. And I'm like, you don't get it, do you? But when you walk into that cloud of smoke, I think, oh, my God, that's from their lungs. Is that dangerous? No?
That hopefully any of that cigarette vapor will be killing the virus. We do know that if people are coughing, yelling, screaming, shouting, singing loudly, that can create what's called an aerosol-generating procedure that the droplet can be in. But no, it's not going to be hanging out in that puff of smoke.
Okay, Dr. Michael Bauer from Northwestern is with us. Stand by, doctor. We'll come right back. Plus, I'd like to take some phone calls, 312-981-7200, if you have questions about how to stay safe as we are opening back up, and that is what we are talking about. The doctor is in, and he will answer your questions. Lauren Lapka will now answer all your questions about the roadway.
Well, at least some. Naperville police say a large protest is forming near Webster and Jefferson and ask drivers to be cautious when traveling near the downtown area. They say they may close streets if the group decides to march. Over in Riverside, Riverside Road is currently closed northbound between Blooming Bank and Pine for work on the railroad tracks. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
At Midwestern University, healthcare education is what they do. Their campus in Downers Grove features 6 colleges and 12 degree programs. Here you'll benefit from hands-on training, expert faculty mentors, and patient-focused programs. You'll also learn side-by-side with students in other health professions, modeling the team approach to the 21st century healthcare practice. Learn more about their programs at midwestern.edu. That's midwestern.edu. Midwestern University, tomorrow's healthcare team.
In 1925, Modelo began brewing beer for those who believe in better. A model beer, steeped in the tradition of tireless effort. A rich Pilsner-style lager for those who wear their heart and heritage in their rolled-up sleeve. Since our first batch 94 years ago, to every bottle raised today, we've proved that it doesn't matter where you come from. It matters what you're made of. Modelo Especial, brewed for those with a fighting spirit. Drink responsibly. Imported by Crown Imports, Chicago, Illinois.
Hi, this is Jay Farner, CEO of Rocket Mortgage. Making the right financial decisions has never been more important. We can help guide you to those right decisions now, when they matter most. Mortgage rates are near historic lows, so when you call 8338-ROCKET or visit us at rocketmortgage.com to start your refinance, you'll be well on your way to saving money every month. The rate today on our 30-year fixed-rate mortgage is 3.375%, APR 3.59%. Right now could be a great time for you to take some positive financial steps forward with a cash-out refinance from Rocket Mortgage, which could give you the boost that you're looking for. In addition, we may be able to help you refinance with little or no out-of-pocket costs. At Rocket Mortgage, we're committed to every client, every time, no exceptions, no excuses, giving you the best mortgage experience. Call us today at 833-8-ROCKET or go to rocketmortgage.com to learn more.
Rates subject to change. Pay 1.875% fee to receive this discounted rate. Call for cost information and conditions. Equal housing lender. License in all 50 states. NMLS number 3030.
Dr. Michael Bauer is with us from Northwestern Medicine. Thank you very much, sir. Appreciate you spending the time. We'll get to your phone calls at 312-981-7200. He's at Lake Forest Hospital, by the way. And I have noticed that throughout the suburbs of Chicago, people were trying to get out earlier than they were getting out in the city. I think there's a certain amount of fatigue that has kicked in here. And because there are people who live a little bit further away from each other in the suburbs than they do in the city, they don't see as many cases, and they figure it's not actually going to happen to them. Is there a risk to what we're now calling the COVID fatigue?
That there definitely is an inherent risk in the COVID fatigue row. You know, at the onset of this, I think everybody became, for the most part, quite compulsive, very vigilant about all the recommended protective behaviors, washing your hands frequently, sanitizing. Then came out the recommendations for masking, etc. And when this fatigue sets in, there's several reasons that we worry about it. One is just plain out, I'm tired of doing this. Let's get over this now. It's affected my life. I'm tired of this. I don't want to do it anymore. Your brain starts to de-emphasize the actual risk of catching it, and then you start bending the rules a little bit, taking little bits of chances here and there where you may not have been doing that earlier on. Then throw in hearing confusing statements like from the WHO a couple days ago, and you can hear people saying, you know what, I just want to get back to my normal life. The bottom line, the basic recommendations of physical distancing, and we like to refer to it as physical rather than social distancing. We want people to be social, but trying to remain cautious about 6 feet apart from people you don't know that are not family members, et cetera. Masking when you're going to be in close indoor contact with somebody, and being very frequent good hand washing and hand sanitizing. Those are basics now that we should not be getting away from, period.
One of the confusing messages we've had, though, about hand washing and hand sanitizing is we then heard a couple of weeks ago that it is less likely that you're going to be able to get this from touching a surface. What is your thought on that, Doctor?
That there's no question the primary way of spread, and you hear this over and over, is respiratory droplet. But when those droplets potentially get on our hands, and then you touch your mouth, you touch your nose, you touch your eyes, besides just inhaling them, that's also a way of spreading. I don't think people need to be worried about getting their packages from Amazon, leaving the mail sit for a day or two, and touching those types of surfaces. There really has not been shown to be a spread. I liken this to if we went and sort of did a culture around everybody's kitchen sink or in the bathroom, you're going to find a lot of germs and a lot of organisms. We're not getting sick from them. So just because they were able to isolate some viral particle on a surface doesn't really mean that that's necessarily contagious.
It's still a good idea, though, either way. So, wash your hands, right.
Wash your hands and avoid touching your nose, your mouth, and your eyes as much as possible.
Judy, you're on WGN. Go ahead, Judy, you're on with Dr. Michael Bauer from Northwestern Medicine.
Oh, thank you for taking my call. Doctor, my question is about antibody testing. Are there instances where you would recommend it, or maybe it wouldn't be helpful times that it wouldn't be recommended? And what would it tell us if we were to get tested positive for it, especially if we had it early on before the testing was widely available?
That's an excellent question. And again, we don't know a lot about what to tell somebody that is positive for antibody testing, other than you have likely been in contact with a coronavirus. Now, the predominant coronavirus obviously is COVID-19 right now, but there are other coronaviruses. There's also a lot of different antibody tests out there. Some are looking at different parts of the viral particle. So you can have certain antibodies to the outer coating. You can also have antibodies to what's called the spike protein, and those are felt to be what's called neutralizing antibodies, meaning if I was to come in contact with the virus again, those antibodies are going to be able to neutralize the virus and fight it off. We're actually doing a study right now at Northwestern looking at all the healthcare workers, starting with the frontline on down, to look at antibody prevalence right now. And the early data is, I think, going to show that we don't have really a higher rate than the general population right now. So
healthcare.
In the healthcare workers, yeah. at Northwestern. That now, part of that is very effective PPE or personal protective equipment use and being very, very cautious in the healthcare setting. But we just don't know how long those antibodies, if you are positive, are going to last and if they are truly protective. Time will tell on that.
Is there one antibody test that is better than others?
That the ones that are licensed by the FDA, because there's a lot of different ones out there right now, but you want to go with one of the ones from the major laboratory manufacturers that are licensed by the FDA.
So you've got the Abbott, which is the Abbott IgG test, which is an antibody test. And I have heard from medical professionals and even in my own family, I have seen this, where there's a great inconsistency in the results from that particular, there's concern, I should say, about great inconsistency in that test. Would you agree with that? And is there a better test?
Well, I'm not sure what you mean by inconsistency. We've actually
false
seen
negatives.
Right. So we've seen that in people that had tested positive, that had known disease, that the antibody test tends to correlate very well, meaning it's positive when you've had known disease. A false negative would say, gee, I had the disease, but my antibody test is coming up negative. We have not seen that with that particular test here.
Okay. All right. And now that people are starting to get back to work, you guys are getting back to work in the medical profession as well. There are people who have been putting off going to the dentist or going to go get a checkup or going to continue on with some sort of therapeutic care that they were getting. Is it safe to go back into a medical setting?
Absolutely. It has really been safe from the beginning of this pandemic. People don't get COVID by going to a healthcare setting or by going to a hospital. And it's actually, unfortunately, the reverse that we're seeing, where people have been sitting home that normally would have come in, ignoring that chest pain that subsequently goes away, but then they come in and we realize you had a heart attack during that time. And unfortunately, we lost that window of being able to take you to the cath lab, put a stent in, open up that blocked vessel, and you've now suffered damage. Same thing with people that have had strokes. We've seen abdominal emergencies where they normally would have come in and had their appendix taken out, but sat at home and unfortunately let it get to the point where it now became a ruptured appendix and they were much sicker. We actually have very good data to show that we've collected on putting off these types of both emergent and routine screenings can have harmful effects. People putting off mammograms where we're not picking up on things early enough, or colon cancer screening. It's very, very important. If you think that you should have been going in, you need to be going in to get checked, both for those emergent and now the routine healthy screening things. Immunization rates for children, unfortunately, dropped dramatically. That, we know, is a recipe for disaster.
All right. Dr. Bauer, thank you very much. Dr. Michael Bauer from Northwestern Medicine, Lake Forest Hospital. Thank you, sir. Appreciate it. We have the news from the Northwestern Medicine Newsroom coming your way in 2 minutes.
Wake up with Bob Surratt.
Wake up and get the day going with Bob Surratt. He has all you need 5 a.m. to 9 on Chicago's very own
WGN. Your home is your castle, your refuge, your safe place.
Our job at 1-800-GOT-JUNK is to make junk disappear.
And we're good at it.
Your home will feel bigger.
And cleaner.
And you'll feel happier.
We promise.
Give us a call.
Or go to our website.
And your junk will magically disappear as our truck drives past your home.
Well, almost.
We'll be in and out before you can blink.
And our gloved professionals touch nothing except the things you want to disappear.
Call 1-800-GOT-JUNK.
Or visit 1-800-GOT-JUNK.com.
Liberty Mutual Insurance Company helps you customize your home insurance so you only pay for what you need. Unlike things you paid for you didn't need, like that much-needed 125-inch flat-screen TV.
It's hurting my eyes. A lot.
Or your 100-square-foot bedroom.
My neck isn't so much stiff as it's completely stuck.
With Liberty Mutual, get customized home insurance so you only pay for what you need.
Uh-oh, I'm seeing color splotches.
Liberty, Liberty, Liberty. Liberty.
Only pay for what you need at libertymutual.com.
Does your basement only leak when it rains? At PermaSeal, we believe your basement should be dry all the time. For a free estimate, you know who to call. 800-421-SEAL or visit permaseal.net.
Your best for being better, PermaSeal.
WGN News in 1 minute. Mental health is a priority during the COVID-19 pandemic, and ketamine centers of Chicago are there for you. Coronavirus outbreak is increasing anxiety, increasing isolation, promoting social withdrawal, triggering feelings of uncertainty and hopelessness. Pandemic is not only threatening your physical health, but your mental health as well. There is help. Ketamine treatment has been declared an essential service during these times, and Ketamine Centers of Chicago are taking all CDC recommended precautions to give you a safe experience. Dr. Bal Nandri uses ketamine to treat major depression, anxiety, chronic pain, PTSD, called one of the greatest advancements in mental health. Most people find relief in a few hours or days. Treatment involves 6 IV infusions over 2 weeks in a private, monitored setting. Schedule your free, no-obligation consultation by calling 844-9-IV-MEDS. That's 844-9-IV-MEDS. Or visit KetamineChicago.com, K-E-T-A-M-I-N-E, Chicago.com. These are confusing and uncertain times. Ketamine Centers of Chicago are there for you. News right now.
Serving the great Midwest from Chicago, this is WGN at AM 720 on your radio and on smart devices anywhere just by saying play WGN Radio on TuneIn.
WGN Chicago.
A Nexstar Media Group station.
77 degrees at 4:01. Good afternoon. I'm Kim Gordon. The news is sponsored by LindholmRoofing.com. We heard what goes on behind closed doors. Mayor Lightfoot responding to leaked audio that shows a heated argument between her and a city alderman.
Just coming up within the last moments or so, NASCAR says goodbye to the Confederate flag. More on that in sports.
And in business, Governor Pritzker signs the state budget. WGN Traffic, here's Lauren Lapka.
And this report is sponsored by DuckDuckGo Privacy. A disabled vehicle inbound on the Kennedy is partially blocking the exit ramp at Armitage. It's 27 minutes from O'Hare and 20 minutes back out. Traffic is heavy inbound on the Eisenhower from Ashland. It's 37 from 390 and 35 minutes on the outbound side. Outbound Stevenson is now stop and go between Ashland and Pulaski. It's 33 to Veterans Memorial. Still no issues inbound. A stall inbound on the Dan Ryan is blocking the left center lane at 18th. It's 20 minutes from 95th and 22 back out. Want the same internet but more privacy? DuckDuckGo's got you covered. They help millions of people like you get privacy online without any trade-offs. With one download, you can search and browse privately, avoiding trackers, all for free. DuckDuckGo, privacy simplified. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
The news is next, but first the WGN forecast. Here's meteorologist Demetrius Ivory.
We're expecting scattered showers and thunderstorms to be possible mainly early tonight, with the low temperature down to 60. Tomorrow, sunshine comes our way. Thursday's high temperature will be in the upper 70s and low 80s. On Friday, more sunshine, lower humidities. The high temperature climbs to about 78. Saturday, we'll see sunshine during the afternoon. The high temperature 68. And Sunday, we complete a nice weekend with mostly sunny skies. High temps in the mid-70s. I'm WGN meteorologist Demetrius Ivory.
Mayor Lightfoot responding to the release of a tape in which he's heard swearing at Alderman Raymond Lopez, and he swore back. It was about the city's response to protests and looting. She says that conversation was illegally recorded.
There were a lot of incredible emotions that were shared on that call by fellow aldermen, now all of whom don't feel secure or safe coming together with their colleagues because of one individual who decided to illegally tape a conversation.
She says the audio was only a part of a more than an hour and a half long conversation. She did not name the alderman who taped it, but said, quote, "I think we know who it is." Illinois Senator Dick Durbin calling on Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell to bring the Justice and Policing Act to the Senate immediately for a vote.
We owe it not just to the Senate. We owe it to George Floyd, to Breonna Taylor, to Ahmaud Arbery, and all of the black and brown lives that we've lost in these brutal acts of racial injustice.
The bill will end chokeholds, no-knock warrants, and require police officers to use their dash and body cameras. White House Press Secretary Kayleigh McEnany says President Trump will not consider renaming military bases that are named after Confederate leaders from the Civil War.
These monumental and very powerful bases have become part of a great American heritage and a history of winning, victory, and freedom.
She made the statement in a news briefing after the president tweeted about not tampering with magnificent and fabled military installations. He added, quote, "respect our military" in the tweet. President Trump's approval rating is down 10 points. According to a Gallup poll, only 39% of voters approve of his work, while 57% disapprove. It reflects one of the largest drops in a single month period. The poll also reflects how Trump has dealt with the pandemic and nationwide protests in response to George Floyd's death. Grubhub is about to get a taste of European cuisine. Dutch-based Just Eat Takeaway is closing in on a deal to merge with the Chicago-based company.
Uber Eats had been in talks to buy Grubhub for several months, with things heating up recently. They cooled after worries about antitrust issues. JustEatTakeaway.com is based in the Netherlands, and acquiring Grubhub will set the table for a U.S. presence. Steve Bertrand, WGN News.
Governor Pritzker signed a $43 billion state spending plan today. It relies heavily on federal aid to plug holes in the budget due to the pandemic. The budget was approved last month by lawmakers during a short special session last month. And now with WGN Community Corners, here's Ryan Burrow.
Baby Hope's garden, planted in memory of Baby Hope, has been moved to the end of DuPage County Sheriff's Office property in Wheaton. It's made of raised garden beds and tended to by DuPage County inmates. It includes 75 tomato plants, 75 pepper plants, zucchini, cucumber, and herbs. The sheriff's office says it's expected to grow as much as 1,500 pounds of produce in its first year. I'm Ryan Burrow with Community Corners on WGN Radio.
WGN Sports, here's Andy Mazur.
Big announcement by NASCAR just a few moments ago. It is banning the use of the Confederate flag at its events and properties. Bubba Wallace, the lone black driver in the sport, was calling this week the time for the stock car series with deep ties to the South to ban the flag. And today they have come through and done that. The players are moving forward to Major League Baseball with their latest proposal for starting the pandemic-delayed season. They are offering to cut the regular season to 89 games, a day after MLB cut its proposed schedule to 76 games. However, the two sides remain far apart economically. The players remain adamant that they receive their full prorated salaries. Each side, though, in agreement on an expanded playoff featuring as many as 16 teams. Even with the turmoil and getting baseball back underway, the draft will start tonight. First round and compensatory picks. This year's draft just five rounds down from the normal 40. The White Sox will select number 11. The Cubs at number 16. Detroit has the first overall pick. Hockey is almost back, and there were Patrick Kane, Alex DeBrincat, Alex Nylander, and Malcolm Subban to prove it. Those players return to the Hawks practice facility to begin some voluntary workouts as part of phase two of the NHL's return to play plan. The Hawks will be the 12th seed in the Western Conference when the playoffs begin next month. And former Major League Baseball All-Star Claudel Washington passed away today at the age of 65. Washington played three seasons for the White Sox from 1978 through 1980. He had a 17-year Major League career. On the home of the Blackhawks, Northwestern Wildcats, and White Sox baseball, Andy Mazur, WGN Sports.
Your money on WGN. The Dow closed down 282 points, NASDAQ up 66, the S&P 500 down 17 points. I'm Kim Gordon on Chicago's very own 720 WGN.
Hello, folks. Orion here again. And if you're in the market for a new Subaru, then Gary Lang Subaru is the name I trust. Right now, experience their touchless car buying system at GaryLangSubaru.com. Simply select your favorite Subaru model from their vast inventory, Legacy, Impreza, Forester, Outback, Crosstrek, or Ascent. Secure your financing, get an instant trade offer, and your car will be delivered to your door. Or you can schedule an appointment in their sanitized showroom. Folks, visit Gary Lang Subaru, just minutes away from anywhere on Route 31 between McHenry and Crystal Lake, or complete your entire purchase online at GaryLangSubaru.com. You can't afford to buy or lease a new Subaru anywhere else. And remember, if it doesn't say Gary Lang on the back, you probably paid too much.
We're all navigating uncertain times. A big part of that includes concerns over financial security. At Wintrust, we're ready to help. As Chicago's bank, we're committed to supporting this area. Whether you're looking for refinance solutions to take advantage of low rates and reduced payments, or an account that offers 15 times the standard FDIC insurance, we've got you covered. We're in this together. We'll get through it together. Find a location to call at wintrust.com/findus. Member FDIC, Equal Housing Lender.
So I urge people who were part of the first hour listening, if you were there, thank you for staying with us. I urge people to stay tuned for this conversation that we're about to have. As unrest has descended upon Chicago over the last couple of weeks, and right there twinned with the horrors of the COVID-19 pandemic throughout the nation and also here, although luckily Chicago was spared what New York or certainly what Wuhan or some of the other cities in Italy had gone through, but it's still, you know, not been an easy ride here. I started to think about the fact that civil unrest, the last great moment of civil unrest in Chicago, was, I mean, if you don't count the 68 riots, but of racial civil unrest, and there, this is certainly based in a lot of that, was 1919. In the book that was written by Mike Royko, Boss, about the life and times of Richard J. Daley, the mayor of Chicago from 1955 to 1976, that he was, that opening scene in that particular book, that biography, is about the 1919 riots in Chicago, in the summer of Chicago. And I want to bring in a history professor to talk a little bit about that, because it occurred to me that 1919 was also the middle of a pandemic. And I wanted to see if there was some sort of connectivity, or at least we could land on some sort of connectivity. Bill Tuttle is with us. He is from the University of Kansas. And he's got a book out called Race Riot, Chicago in the Red Summer of 1919. I know you wrote that book a number of years ago. And let's investigate that for just a second. I don't want to get all NPR-ish here, but it just okay. It hit me that there was a connectivity between going through a pandemic and then race riots, which, by the way, were not just here in 1919. They were all across the country. So yeah, talk a little bit about what caused Chicago.
What caused Chicago, as you said, was part of a pattern of race riots all over the country, 25 race riots in the summer of 1919, some ranging from race wars, which was what Chicago was. In Chicago, 38 people were killed, 23 black, 15 white. Most of the blacks were killed by the police, and the blacks again killed 15 whites. So it was very much of a race war, ranging from race wars in Chicago to a racial massacre in Arkansas in the Mississippi Delta, cotton country, where 200 people, mostly blacks, were killed by white mobs. So again, 25 race riots. Some of the race riots were, again, race wars. Other were Others were racial massacres. This came after World War One, and so I was very interested in the Red Summer of 1919, and especially the Chicago race riot of 1919. I think there are some comparisons between what is happening today and what happened back in 1919, but there's a substantial difference as well. The 1919 race riots were extremely bloody. As I said, 38 in Chicago, 200 in Arkansas, hundreds of people elsewhere. So very, a lot bloodier than today. There's been enough violence today, and it's all so regrettable, but there's very little compared to what happened in 1919. Also, I think today there's an odd sort of a dichotomy going, because I think the case of George Floyd speaks not only to the shame of our history, to police brutality especially, but also to the promise of the future. And I think that's what these marches are all about. And they really inspire hope in me. There was really very little hope that came out of the Red Summer of 1919.
Yeah.
It sort of fed into the Ku Klux Klan in the 1920s.
Does seem to have a parallel, though, to what there was obviously unrest. There was economic unrest in the aftermath of World War One. You had people
right.
coming back. World War One, aren't the United States... participation in World War One very different than it was in World War Two. We got in very late in World War One, and it was a limited number of troops, and the American military wasn't the size back then of what it is now.
The military experience is quite important to these race riots. The 8th Illinois in Chicago is a large black unit, and they came back in the spring of 1919 to great applause. And these were men who'd been trained to shoot and kill, and they'd been in combat in France. And I think the same thing actually happened in Tulsa briefly in 1921, where the black veterans organized and stopped the whites for a while. So I think I think World War One is not as big as World War Two, as you said, but I think it had a major impact on cities like Chicago and New York and Tulsa.
Do you have any sense, I know this is not part of your research, but Dr. Tuttle, do you have any sense that there was any connectivity between the social disruption of the pandemic of 1919, which did hit the East Coast, and it hit Chicago and St. Louis and a lot of places, you know,
very, very
hard, that had anything to do with that?
You know, actually, the influenza panic started in Kansas, but you're right, it went every place. Major, major loss of life. The research that I did, for example, in the Chicago Defender newspaper, and I interviewed people as well and went into government records, I didn't find much. But it could be that I wasn't looking for it. You know, historians sort of select what they're interested in, and I didn't find much evidence that it had an impact on the riots, but you're quite right, it might have.
Yeah.
It might well have been. You know, one thing I said, well, one major factor in intensifying the riots was heat. And people said, well, we never thought about that. Well, it's pretty obvious. And there could have been a connection, but I'm not aware of one.
Right. Well, heat in 1919 in the Chicago riots were incredibly important because they started on the beaches, right? I mean, many of them took place on the beaches, and that's where... That's where the book Boss comes in here, because it starts with that scene.
And that involves the police as well. And clearly one other parallel between now and then was relations between blacks and the police were terrible. Police were from ethnic groups in Chicago that hated blacks. They had different political affiliations. They lived across the street from each other on Wentworth Avenue, which was the dividing line between black Chicago and mostly white Irish Chicago. So very bad relations. And so when the race riot started, as you said, a group of five black teenagers had been floating on a raft they'd built out in the out in Lake Michigan behind the Michael Reese Hospital. They floated into an area that some white man thought was a white area, whites-only swimming area. So he began throwing rocks at them, and one rock hit a black boy named Eugene Williams, and he drowned. And yet the white police officer, Callahan, on duty, would not arrest the white man who threw the stone. And that's when the riot really took off.
Yeah. As you, Professor Tuttle, as you look at where we are now, what hope do you see that things may get better?
Well, I just read something that gave me a lot of hope. 2 years ago, 40% of the people in the U.S. supported Black Lives Matter. That figure now, 2 years later, is 74%. It's almost, and this was in the Washington Post this morning. Yeah. So I think that's very encouraging. I think this longstanding problem of police brutality. I grew up in Detroit, and police brutality was everywhere. Some of it was caused by guys I'd gone to high school with who became police officers and who killed black people. I know they did. So this has been going on for a long time. But in white America, at any rate, information of it has been pretty well restricted to the black community. I think many white people didn't realize how horrible it is. But to talk to any black man in America today, they've all had many, many unfortunate experiences with the police.
Yeah. Professor, we're going to leave it there, but I appreciate your time.
Hey, great to talk to you.
Nice to talk to you, and we should also mention that we went to the same undergraduate school, and I'm very proud of that.
Oh,
I love
Denison.
When we were looking for a professor who'd written about 1919, your name came up, and you won the battle because of Denison. Go Big Red.
Well, great.
Thank you very much, Professor.
Thank you, Conn. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bill Tuttle from the University of Kansas, actually, is a professor and historian there. All right, now, so that was a bit of the historical context I want to talk about here for the city of Chicago, because on the other side, I want to play some of the interview that Bob Surratt did with the Fraternal Order of Police President, the newly elected Fraternal Order of Police President, earlier today on WGN, and get your reaction to it at 312-981-7200. But first, here is Lauren Lapka. She's got the WGN traffic.
Well, the weather may seem nice now, but still seeing issues from earlier storms. On the southwest side, there's a fallen tree on Avers near 47th. In Harvey, a tree has fallen on top of a vehicle at 148th and Wood Street. As for other issues, there's a demonstration in Naperville gathered around Jefferson and Webster, and police say there could be intermittent road closures if the group starts to move. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
Wake up with Bob Surratt.
Wake up and get the day going with Bob Surratt. He has all you need 5 a.m. to 9 on Chicago's very own
WGN. So, Chicago, you may have heard the local legend that if you eat an ear of corn from the farmer outside of town, you'll sprout an extra pinky toe. While we cannot confirm or deny the validity of the Plus One Pinky Toe Corn, we can tell you GEICO has been saving people money for over 75 years.
I wouldn't want a pinky toe around for over 75 years.
We can agree on that. We can also agree that GEICO's longevity is likely due to the fact that they treat people right, like how they're always around when you need them, with 24/7 access to licensed agents.
An extra pinky toe gives you 24/7 access to discomfort.
True words. I imagine GEICO will be around for another 75 years if they keep giving people military and federal discounts.
A surplus pinky toe couldn't help you with any of that. It'd be too busy making your shoes fit all weird.
GEICO. You could get legendary savings and more at geico.com, over the phone, or at your local office.
Worried about visiting a doctor these days? At North Shore University Health System, we're practicing the latest COVID-19 safety protocols to protect you in every North Shore facility. From conducting screenings on every patient and requiring masks, to maintaining social distancing and equipping our staff with the proper protective equipment. We also offer telehealth for care online or on the phone without leaving home. Rest assured, at North Shore, we're taking every step to ensure your safety. Visit northshore.org/telehealth.
Apple Chevy is back and open for business, and trust me, the folks at Apple Chevrolet know the importance of safety. They're continuing to step up their sanitation and disinfecting process, ensuring the absolute safest and healthiest car buying experience around. With some of the best pricing of the year, no interest financing, deferred payments, sign and drive leases, Chevy's most popular vehicles getting the best discounts, right now is the perfect time to buy. Or if you're more comfortable shopping from home, Apple Chevy will bring their showroom to you. It's never been more convenient to shop for a car. They'll bring any new or pre-owned vehicle to your home, and they will appraise your trade-in vehicle on the spot. So stop by Apple Chevrolet today or schedule an at-home vehicle test. Call 708-429-3000, 708-429-3000, or visit applechevy.com. When you're shopping for a Chevy, pick Apple Chevrolet. Find new roads.
When it comes to the weather, we all want to know, what did Skilling say? Watch for updated forecast from Chicago's most trusted meteorologist, Tom Skilling, weeknights on WGN-TV.
All right, so this morning, Bob Surratt talked to the Fraternal Order of Police President, John Cantazara, who is a former Chicago police officer. Now he's the head of the FOP. And it was a really contentious election to be the, and this is Lodge 7, which represents Chicago police officers specifically. And it was a contentious election. That organization has its own share of infighting. But I found this to be a really interesting interview this morning because there's so many issues that are right at the very top of people's consciousness on this. And I want to start with this because Bob starts with a reaction to, so we're going to start with what Sir Candizero was talking about in terms of why police officers are making the number of arrests in the black community that they are. And then Bob follows up with this question. So listen to Mr. Candizero.
If this is the incident that's going to be the litmus test, then explain to me how race had anything to do with it. There's no proof or evidence that race had anything to do with it. You know, some people are just violent by nature. Unfortunately, every now and then, some of those people end up wearing a badge. They're not necessarily picking out a certain demographic to express their newfound power on. I don't see how that incident in Minnesota was a racial incident as much as it was just bad police tactics, period.
John, there are numbers that are alarming and that would present a different picture than what you just said. More than 1,000 people died as a result of police harm between 2013 and 2019. A third were blacks. That is a disproportionate number and indicates something is wrong.
Is that what it indicates?
I would think so.
Well, I would disagree with you because, and people don't like this necessary association, but, you know, when we're talking about violent jihadist, the extremist, religious extremists, we're talking specifically about the Muslim religion, right? I'm not talking all Muslims are bad here, so don't get me wrong. But you don't go looking for Irish Catholic terrorists unless you're in Ireland looking for IRA members. When you're looking for jihadists, you're looking for Muslim religious people. That's who's committing those things. When you're talking about violent felons in the city of Chicago specifically, because that's where I represent members at, the predominant violence is in four neighborhoods. Those neighborhoods are African-American neighborhoods. I cannot control what the reality is in front of all of us, but that's where the violence is happening. That's where the majority of the arrests are going to take place. I don't see how this is not a logical conclusion for everybody to come to.
One of the things that struck me when I heard that this morning was that may well be true. What he's talking about in terms of dangerous neighborhoods, yes, that I think it's four out of the top five dangerous neighborhoods in Chicago in terms of violence, gun violence, and shootings are in black neighborhoods, and then the fifth being in a predominantly Latinx neighborhood. That, however, is an inverted way of looking at it. So the thought that came through my head, and I'd like to get your phone calls on this too, at 312-981-7200, which is you're looking at the race and the crime as a coexistent idea. There are many people in those neighborhoods that are not criminals. There are many people in those neighborhoods who live in the fear of those criminals, whether they're gang members or they are just violent actors, as the FOP president talked about. And I think that's part of the language issue or part of the communication issue that's going on here, is that the frustration that a lot of African Americans or members of the Black Lives Matters, you know, protests, people are saying, well, you're looking at it the other way. So when a police officer goes into that neighborhood, the idea that the FOP president just put in it, the idea that came to my head listening to that was, well, then we're going to the black neighborhoods because that's where the black crime is. And so we're going to arrest black people. And that may or may not, the person that's being pulled over may or may not be a troublemaker, if you will. Now, I want to put two more things from this, too. This is the FOP president of the Chicago Lodge talking about looting.
When you're talking about specific things, then you're going to obviously focus on specific demographics, period. If you're talking about violence in the city of Chicago, the predominant amount of violence occurs in very specific neighborhoods. Of course, that's where the arrests are going to occur, period. The looting was not occurring in Norridge Park, in Clearing, in Garfield Ridge, in Mount Greenwood. There was no looting going there. Those are predominantly the, you know, the white police areas that everybody likes to talk about in the city of Chicago, but yet there was no looting going on there, right?
That is true. That is true. There was no mass looting in those areas. That is correct. Maybe factually correct. It doesn't actually help solve this problem that we're having, the general problem of saying, okay, well, then the looters are black. We're going to arrest all the black people. Again, arresting the looters is fine. And I'm going to tell you that Brickyard Mall video that we've all seen now where the police officers are smashing in the windows of those cars, wait for that report to come out. It's not going to be how it was presented necessarily as news reports were indicating early on in this, and you just had witness accounts, and you had the lawyers for some of the families' accounts. Watch that story. That's going to change, and that goes to the issue of looting. I understand that. But we need to have that conversation in a very very real and specific way. 312-981-7200 is our telephone number. Mike, you're on WGN. Go ahead, Mike.
Oh, thank you, Ro. I just wanted to talk a little bit about the FOP guys' comments. I find that there's just a lot of prejudice against neighborhoods here, and that a lot of neighborhoods are viewed as jungles. And I can understand how a police officer who deals with criminals all day doesn't really get a sense of the positive things that are occurring in these neighborhoods. And I think the ability to see those things might provide a more balanced idea here. And the other thing is that the idea of the police take
and,
a pledge
and
to
may
serve.
May I say something, Mike? May I just jump in on for one moment here? I think there are a lot of police who do go into those neighborhoods and understand the nuance of it. I think there are. There are some who don't. There are some who have been jaded, if you will, through their own life's experience. And guys who are longer on the job or have traumatic experiences may look at this very differently. But I wouldn't, and again, I don't want to paint all the cops with the same brush either, because
no,
that's
I don't
unfair.
Either.
That's the conversation we're trying to have. But go ahead and make your next point.
Well, the pledge is to serve and protect. And I haven't heard a lot of comments about how police actually protect the good people that are in neighborhoods. And maybe it's an obvious thing, but I just think it's really critical. And I think it's really at the heart of what a lot of the issues are here.
Yeah, and it's the messaging. And I think one of the problems that we're having, especially in this era, is messaging, is that sort of brutal rhetoric. Although it may play on social media fairly well, because it cuts through and people, you know, respond to it, because you're, you know, creating a ruckus, if you will, doesn't really help solve these really, really sensitive, tender issues that have been going back, as we just talked about earlier, for hundreds of years. But specifically for 101 years here in Chicago, this has been brewing, and since 1919. And we need, I think, a more detailed and nuanced dialogue. People don't like nuance, man. I can promise you that, as a guy who, you know, works in this business, that nuance often flies over people's heads. They like direct things, and they want to say, and that's where the FOP president, I mean, he cuts through. That's one of the reasons that I'm playing the tape for Bob Surratt this morning, because he is very plain spoken. People go, I like plain spoken people. But just because they're speaking plain doesn't mean that it's necessarily going to be helpful in answering the questions. We'll pick this up a little bit later on in the program. We've got some other things we're going to do. But in the 6 o'clock hour, I'm going to play a couple of other cuts from that interview, and then we'll take more phone calls. We'll have more time for it on the other side. But right now, we have news from the Northwestern Medicine Newsroom.
75 degrees at 4:30. Good afternoon. I'm Kim Gordon. The Cook County Medical Examiner confirms a 9-month-old died from coronavirus.
NASCAR making it clear today, no Confederate flags allowed at its events.
And in business, interest rates will remain the same. WGN Traffic, here's Lauren Lapka.
Inbound Kennedy is back to from Armitage. Right now it's just 25 minutes from O'Hare and 20 minutes back out. Traffic is heavy out on the Eisenhower between Sacramento and Des Plaines. It's 36 to 390 and a half hour back in. Up on Stevenson, that's stop and go until Pulaski. It's 33 to Veterans Memorial. No issues inbound. Up on Dan Ryan, not too bad, but it is 20 minutes out to 95th. Inbound side looks good. And on I-65 North, the entrance ramp at 190. Is closed for road work until June 16th. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
The news is next, but first, Tom Skilling's forecast from the Permaseal Weather Center. Tonight, very windy. A period of showers develop this evening, then clouds scatter, cooler and noticeably less humid overnight, a low of 58. Tomorrow, mostly sunny, continued breezy, seasonably warm, a high of 78. Friday, sunshine with some mixed clouds during the afternoon and evening. Cooler winds off Lake Michigan strengthening during the day. We'll see a high of 66. The Cook County Medical Examiner's Office is confirming an infant who died in March died of complications from COVID-19.
The 9-month-old boy named Joseph Miles died March 23rd at Mercy Hospital in Chicago. The initial test by the Illinois Department of Public Health revealed conflicting results. One test detected the presence of COVID-19 in his lungs. A second test conducted by the medical examiner's office, but later tests on lung tissue detected COVID-19. Further tissue samples were taken in April, the results coming back Friday, determining evidence of COVID-19 in the boy's lungs. Health officials say COVID-19 and coronavirus NL63 induced viral pneumonia, causing Miles' death. Ryan Burrow, WGN News.
In Illinois today, the state confirming 625 new coronavirus cases and 78 additional deaths in the last 24 hours. The total number of cases now over 129,000, and the death toll stands at 6,095. George Floyd's brother, Philonis Floyd, testifying at a House Judiciary Committee hearing today on policing practices and law enforcement accountability. Floyd asking for police reform so his brother's death won't be in vain.
Anybody with a heart, they know that's wrong. You don't do that to a human being. You don't even do that to an animal. His life mattered.
It comes one day after George Floyd was buried next to his mother in Houston. Illinois Senator Dick Durbin adding his name as a sponsor of the Justice in Policing Act. He's calling on Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell to bring the bill to the Senate for an immediate vote.
Our bill would ban chokeholds like the one that killed George Floyd. It will ban no-knock warrants like the one that led to the death of Breonna Taylor.
The bill will also require police officers to use their dash and body cameras and create a police misconduct registry. The Federal Reserve says interest rates will remain near zero for the foreseeable future. The central bank issued their official economic projections since before the pandemic, and they expect the U.S. unemployment rate to remain higher for the next couple of years. Chair Jerome Powell says things at this stage are still very uncertain.
We all want to get back to normal, but a full recovery is unlikely to occur until people are confident that it is safe to re-engage in a broad range of activities.
The Fed foresees the key interest rate staying at zero until at least 2022. Mayor Lightfoot's spending plan for the $1.1 billion in federal money for coronavirus relief for Chicago passed the city's budget committee today. Some aldermen critical of the Chicago Police Department funding call for the mayor to pledge not to use the virus response money to pay for police overtime. The city council will take up the measure next week. And now WGN Sports, here's Andy Mazur.
NASCAR announced within the hour that it's banning the use of the Confederate flag at its events and properties. NASCAR saying the Confederate flag, quote, runs contrary to our commitment to providing a welcoming and inclusive environment for all fans, our competitors, and our industry, end quote. Bubba Wallace, NASCAR's lone black driver, asked the Stock Car Series to formally distance itself from what millions feel as a symbol of slavery and racism, and today NASCAR obliged. Several Blackhawks players returned to the team's practice facility today to begin skating. The workouts are voluntary and part of phase two of the NHL's return to play plan. Among those skating today, Patrick Kane and Alex DeBrincat. The Blackhawks will be the 12th seed in the Western Conference when the playoffs begin next month. And while it's a clear plan in the NHL, the water is still a little bit murky in the world of baseball. Negotiations continue between Major League Baseball and the MLB Players Association in hopes of getting the 2020 season underway. The union countered the owner's offer of a 76-game season with 75% prorated pay with an 89-game schedule and full prorated play. The players' proposal now includes a 16-game postseason play also between 2020 and 2021. Now up to the owners to come up with something of their own. And baseball's amateur draft beginning tonight with the first 37 picks. It'll be a 5-round draft rather than a 40 as usual. The White Sox pick is number 11. The Cubs selected number 16. The Tigers have the number 1 overall pick. on the home of the Blackhawks, Northwestern Wildcats, and White Sox baseball. Andy Mazur, WGN Sports.
Your money on WGN. The Dow closed down 282 points today. NASDAQ up 66. The S&P 500 down 17 points. Gold up today. Oil up 2 cents at $38.96. And the VIX at the CBOE unchanged. I'm Kim Gordon on Chicago's very own 720 WGN.
I clicked on the Joint Relief Institute's website the other day. This is John Williams. I know what you're thinking. John, couldn't you be using your time to find better jokes than the ones you've been telling lately? Well, it didn't take long, and I wanted you to know the first thing I saw at jointreliefinstitute.com. Attention Chicago, you can now eliminate your knee pain with a new treatment in a place that takes COVID-19 precautions very seriously. Yep, getting rid of that knee pain is an essential business. Your first visit is free, and they've got an insurance expert to make sure you get maximum coverage. So let's get maximum pain relief. They'll use digital imaging to see where your knee is failing. They'll put a lubricant painlessly into that exact spot. It's all they do. So go on a safe walk, pain-free. Speaking of walks, what do you call a bunch of rabbits walking backwards? Yep, a receding hairline. Look, if you call 708-888-0000, they'll fix your knee pain, and I'll work harder on these jokes. Call 708-888-0000, as in zero pain.
1-877 Cars for Kids, KARS Cars for Kids. 1-877 Cars for Kids, donate your car today.
1-877 Cars for Kids, KARS Cars for Kids. 1-877 Cars for Kids, donate your car today.
To learn more about our programs and to donate, go to carsforkids.com. That's cars with a K. Pickup is quick and easy. You'll also get a vacation voucher and maximum tax deduction.
1-877 Cars for Kids, KARS Cars for Kids. 1-877 Cars for Kids. Donate your car today.
Also accepting boats, motorcycles, RVs, and real estate donations.
We're going to continue this conversation that we started in the last half hour. We're moving some things around because there are a lot of people texting and calling, wanting to continue the conversation, so we're listening to you. I started by playing a tape this morning of Bob Surratt's interview with the Fraternal Order of Police President, John Cantanzara, who talked to Bob about the arrest of African Americans in Chicago is because the high numbers of those and police involvement with African Americans is because, he says, the crime, and statistically he is right, the crime in the city of Chicago, some of the hottest districts for crime are in black neighborhoods. That is true. However, the conversation I think that people are trying to have here, that we are trying to have as Chicagoans, as whether we're city leaders or we are citizens or we are just people who are on the street who just decide, listen, this is enough is enough, because there is a basic misunderstanding and miscommunication between these two sides. And I want to just play one more piece from Bob's interview, and then we'll come back to the phone calls here, because the FOP president not only said what I just said, he made the comparison of, you know, if you're going to look for a terrorist, you're going to look for a Muslim, not an Irish Catholic. He did actually say those words. Well, if you want me to play that again, I will, but in the interest of time, I'm not. And he also said this when Bob asked him about kneeling you've seen police officers throughout the country, including led by police bosses in some cases, where they will kneel with protesters to show their solidarity for the message.
Well, I've made it very clear to the members of Lodge 7 that that has no place for our members. That is contradicting to our Constitution as a lodge, and it definitely deflates anything remotely associated with fraternalism. And as such, any member of Lodge 7 who is going to take a knee and basically side with protesters while they're in uniform will subject themselves to discipline in the lodge, up to and including expulsion from Lodge 7.
So you would argue, as somebody who is siding for justice and fairness for all?
What you do on your time is your time. When you're doing it in a uniform, you are representing the police department, and as such, you are representing yourself as a member of Lodge 7. So, yes.
Now, what's interesting about that answer is if, as a member of the police department, if the police commander's on that scene, take a knee and ask that the officers take a knee, they're taking a direct order from their actual bosses. Now, they're at their union, and that's a difference, and I understand the difference between and the importance of the union in this particular case, but that does not necessarily follow the dictate of what the police may be doing. Because you could see that happening, because there is a de-escalation that is attempting to be had here between and an understanding, and maybe this is a moment where there is an understanding. It's an unfortunate situation, and you don't have necessarily the best principles. I know there's a whole idea here of whether George Floyd was a hero because of his past criminal activities or whatever, but he is, I will say this in the most traditional sense, a martyr, because he died at a space and a time that were it not for the actions that took place, he wouldn't have. And that creates a martyr. And that is a very, very powerful system. All right, 312-981-7200. We'll go right back to the phone calls here. Let's talk to Sam. You're on WGN. Go ahead, Sam.
Ro, how you doing?
Good.
Well, Ro, what I hear right now, Ro, is that I know that you're involved with a lot of the police actions, what they go with, you know, your functions and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. I don't hear you calling him out. That's what we mean by when our white counterparts would take a role in this. You're not calling him out because I think you know why you're not calling him out. Because you know that you will become a pariah. The stuff that he said right there, and I just listened to you say something about George Floyd's criminal activity. Didn't cause him. That's the reason why he would die. But you made sure you brought that little part up.
No, I'm making the point. Well, I want to explain why I'm doing this.
That's the problem we have right now in this country. And that's why this is going on, because you have a microphone, you have a megaphone right now that you reach thousands of people,
Sam,
more than
explain.
Thousands, and
Sam,
you do not say
Sam,
anything
Sam.
About it.
When okay, Sam, let me explain. I brought that up because that is a criticism that I hear constantly of us in the media. Why don't you bring it up? Why don't you bring up that he had a criminal past? And you know what I say to that? It's irrelevant. It's completely irrelevant, and I've said that over and over and over again. It is irrelevant because once that man was in custody and he was prone and he was handcuffed, that police officer had no right to do what he did. None.
Bro, do you call
I have been
him,
very
you
clear
call this
about
guy out? Do you call this guy out for what he
I'm
just said?
I'm playing this because
no
I think it's
officer,
I think it is self-evident.
No police officer, if they take a knee, bro, that's kind of like that's what we mean by when police officers can't even function because they know if they do something, it goes against what then they're a pariah in their own unit with their own people. And he just shows you exactly that. You cannot do it in this lodge if you are with this lodge. That just goes to show you there's not going to be any change within the police department because you got people in head in charge, just like that guy right there who holds a big stick and he's going to use it.
Okay.
And that's what we mean by there will be no change.
Excellent point. And my point in saying that if a police commander told him to do it, there's a difference between being on the job and being in a union, right?
If Conn right now would call that out,
I think it's wrong.
Conn
I just
with
did.
These police officers. Conn is on the
did.
Board of some of these actions that the police officers take, and they do. If Conn would use his microphone as he should instead of hiding behind it and call that out, a lot of things would change. But you're not going to do it, Ro, because we know why you're not going to do it. At least I've listened to you for years, many of you, since you started. And I know how you are. I know what happened. And I know you're not going to use that microphone, Ro, because you never have. Not for no police action. No, you haven't. Thanks for the call, Ro. I appreciate you taking my call. Thanks.
Thank you. All right. I'm playing this for a reason. And I would like to make the point incredibly clear for Sam, if he hasn't heard it. I said there is a difference between being a member of a union and being a sworn police officer in a uniform. And if the bosses take the knee. A police officer may or may not do that in his own. And I don't think it's right, because I don't think it's in the spirit of the moment. I think what the FOP president did there is he is perpetuating the problem. I thought his interview with Bob Surratt this morning showed that from the FOP's position, or at least from that one individual president's position of the FOP, that he is going to be creating more division than he is, and ultimately a harder job for his lodge members than there needs to be, because there does need to be reconciliation. There does need to be understanding. That is the reason I am playing these tapes. That is the reason that we are covering this on WGN. That's the reason I'm talking about it. And yes, I am on the board of the Police Memorial Foundation because I want to help police officers do their job more safely. And I want to honor those who are lost, because they are dying for us as the citizens of the city of Chicago. But that does not mean that I am going to ever forgive or I'm going to ever condone a violent, illegal action on behalf of a police officer against a citizen. Ever. Ever. And I never have. The point is, we need to have this conversation, because there is, I played this tape last week of the caller, that the African-American police officer who I believe was on the Chicago job. He didn't want to say specifically, but he talked about what it's like to be both black and blue. And this is a difficult, nuanced conversation we have to have. So I am calling out. I'd also like to call out those who criticize me for not taking a position, because I am taking the position. We'll come right back to your phone calls. 312-981-7200. But first, here's Lauren Lapka. She's got the traffic.
In Elk Grove Village, a semi-fire is blocking Higgins between Landmeyer and Nichols. There's also a vehicle fire northbound on the tri-state on the left shoulder near Route 176. Meanwhile, the demonstration in Naperville is growing, about 100 people now. That's around Jefferson and Webster, as well as Chicago and Washington. No closures yet, but that could happen if the group starts to move. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
Lindeman Chimney Heating and Cooling. That's right, Lindeman Chimney and Fireplace is now Lindeman Chimney Heating and Cooling. With over 50 years of world-class customer service, trust Lindeman to keep your family safe and comfortable all year long. With summer around the corner, now's the time to get your annual air conditioning tune-up by the pros at Lindeman Chimney Heating and Cooling. Normally $150, but for WGN listeners, just $97. The best $97 you'll spend all year. To schedule, go to Lindeman.com. That's Lindeman.com.
At Amida Health, they believe there's no one quite like you. So they offer care focused on your needs, with individualized treatment plans and doctors and nurses who embrace you like family. With hundreds of locations and online scheduling, accessing their compassionate care is easy and convenient. Learn more at AmidaHealth.org/access. To find a doctor, call 855-MY-AMIDA. Amida Health, in sickness and in health.
You can rely on Blaine's Farm and Fleet for the best prices on products that deliver, like Craftsman tools and workshop accessories. Right now, save on a fixed-height Craftsman workshop stool with a rip and tear resistant vinyl seat. The frame is chip, scratch, rust, and corrosion resistant, so it will look great for years to come. On sale, $39.99. Rewards members pay $37.99. That's genuine value from Blaine's Farm and Fleet. The original, authentic, still family-owned since 1955.
Our world has changed. When you leave your home, face coverings are the new normal, but the kind you use really matters, and not all offer the same protection. Boomer Naturals has covered three layers of ultra-soft, breathable cloth infused with nano-silver technology, available in adult and children sizes, and Boomer Naturals cloth is made for use up to 30 days when hand-washed between uses. Order now at BoomerNaturals.com. Use the code BOB20 at checkout and save 20%. Free shipping on any order over $50. To the phones, we return 312-981-7200. We started this conversation replaying some of Bob Surratt's interview with the Fraternal Order of Police president earlier today, and that has lit some things up. As a matter of fact, Lori Lightfoot has even responded to some of the things that, and we're going to play that for you in just a moment, but some of the things that the FOP president has said about this, and getting your reaction. 312-981-7200. Here is Ray. You're on WGN. Go ahead, Ray.
Yeah, bro. When we watch TV and see all these news reports about violence from the police and that, every time that you see something like that, it's because person that police are violent to don't obey what the cops tell them to. And it seems every time that you see something like this, it's because the person hasn't done what the cop told them to. Even in Floyd's situation there, he's a big man, for one thing. And then when they were putting him in the squad car, he tried to get out on the other side. You know, I mean, it's just like, you know, if you would just do what the cop tells you to and sit there and obey, say yes, sir, no, sir, and whatever you want to do, sir, and everything would be all right. I just don't understand why this keeps going on.
Okay, let me ask you this. Two things. You did say yes, sir, no, sir. Once he's on the ground and he's handcuffed and the officer's knee is on his neck and he's calling him sir the entire time, pleading with him to get his knee off his neck, should the officer take his knee off his neck?
You're right. There's no excuse for that. Absolutely no excuse for that.
All right, and let me throw one other thing at you, too, because this is the other piece that you say that, and we hear this all the time, that just go ahead, go along with the police. It's going to be just fine. Now, as a white guy who is one-third less likely to be killed by police in an encounter if there was to be a death than a black man would in the United States, I would go along, right? I understand, as the caller earlier said, I'm involved in a lot of things with police, so I get it, and I would comply, not fearing for my life. There are a lot of African-Americans who just know, based on their experiences and the experiences of their family members, that they may be, just by cooperating, risking their life. They believe that. And I can't really tell them that they are 100% wrong in all cases.
Well, I sure think that they are. I think, you know, I mean, that's, I don't, I'm not good at words, but, you know, as these things have gotten worse and worse and worse, it's because of more disobedience or lack of respect for the cops.
Well, there has been that for a long time, but there's, and police will tell you that. And police, and listen, we played tapes before any of this happened. We were playing tapes from the beginning of the lockdown and in neighborhoods where there were block parties going on and the mayor wanted to break them up. And Ray, I appreciate your call. Thank you, sir. Thank you for listening. And you had young African American kids. I mean, essentially, you know, boys and girls and, you know, young adults. That were between 15 and 25, I would guess, in this large group. And police were coming in to break it up because they were going to break up a street party. The street parties can get very dangerous late at night. There are a lot of examples, practical examples, of those street parties resulting in shootings and death. And so police are called in, and the neighbors get freaked out by it. And the neighbors are the ones calling 911 to say, hey, there's 300 kids or 100 kids or whatever it is on the street corner. Can you do something about it? Police come, they arrive, they try to break it up. And the abuse that the police take in that. So you got to look at it from that perspective as well. But again, this is the point, that this is the conversation we have to have. We have to be honest on both sides of this conversation, not just one, but both. Mark, you're on WGN. Go ahead, Mark.
Hi, Ro. So when you look at the bigger problem here, I mean, we have police responding to violence, and it seems like a lot of the violence, a predominant amount of it, is generated by gangs. So when you look at the gangs that have the stranglehold in Chicago, you have to try to find a way to extract the really, really bad people out of that gang or get the gangs to convert to something. So there has to be kind of like almost a peace offering here. You have to come in and offer amnesty to everybody and say, look, here we're going to kind of educate people. We're going to job train you, maybe. Go out and get tattoo parlors. Go out and start pot farms. Go out and do, you know, car customs. Do something. Get a established business enterprise. Give these people a means to success so they can get training, they can get businesses established, they have a way to make money that's going to supplant what they were getting from the gangs. Because the whole problem is you don't have anything to support these people, so they turn to gangs. If we can get the gangs to something peaceful, you know, if they want to do battles, have them do a rap battle, have them do a chef battle, have them do a custom car battle, have them do fun things. But first give them this opportunity and say, look, one time amnesty, you guys turn peaceful. Give them an opportunity. If they do not turn peaceful, then you have technological means that come down on them. You do things like what they did is they had this technology in Afghanistan where they're looking for roadside bombers. They have planes that fly over, do high surveillance photos, and they go back and forward in time. And you can look at a specific point. You can get the time that the thing happened and go backward and forward and look at who came and went from that spot and where they go to or where they come from.
Well, that technology
is actually...
You kind of
have that technology to really pinpoint and then put police on certain exact events and basically try to then pinpoint police activities to really get success on those events. And then kind of you have to have, you know, really strict rules then in place to put those people away, put the bad people away, the repeat offenders, and keep them away.
Okay. Two things. One, that technology does exist in Chicago. And
yes,
they do use technology, and federal government uses drone technology and surveillance and aircraft surveillance all the time in criminal prosecution in the United States. So that does happen, and exactly what you are describing happens. Obviously, you know, can't do drone strikes in the United States of America. I mean, no one would ever think that that's a good idea. But the idea of using that intelligence and surveillance and reconnaissance capability is, you're right, appropriate. I want to go back to the whole idea of the gang. And if you can somehow create an economic alternative for these young men primarily to go in a different direction than to go in the gang, that is well and good, except that the gang will kill you for not joining it, and or hurt you or a member of your family for not joining it. And that is where that's one of the break pieces in this. And then once the kids kind of get in, and they start to get in their, you know, 10, 11, 12-year-olds start to get wooed in, and then 13, 14, they start to become operative in it. And that's where you really have to interrupt that chain. And you're right. And there are some economic overlays. But people who want to say, and you hear a lot of political leaders say, well, if we just had economic empowerment in these neighborhoods, we wouldn't have this problem. That is only half of the problem. Yes, you did. These
No, understood. Understood.
They have to be more. We definitely have to be. Have a better economic reality for folks, but this is there are other factors, and I really appreciate your call. Thank you very much. Thanks, Mark.
Thanks, Ray. Right,
let's do this. Let's go to the Northwestern Medicine Newsroom in 2 minutes.
Chicago's very own WGN.
Hi, it's Lindsay of House Smarts Radio. You've heard me talk about Builder's Supply Outlet for years, but now hear from their customer Marnie in Western Springs.
So working with Lane was great because I came in and I showed her pictures of the different designs that I was looking for my bathroom. She would help me. We walked through the aisles. We pulled different pieces together to see what it looked like. And at other stores, it was not the same experience at all. And she helped me look at countertops that would match with the tile, paint colors. She told me to go with a herringbone pattern, which I did, and it was amazing. Overall experience was great. She was there for me all the time. Any question I had, she would answer. I'm so glad I went there, and I'm still going back there because I'm buying all my doors.
Another satisfied customer. But remember, we're so much more than bath tile. Builder's Supply Outlet is located just 5 miles east of the Oak Brook Shopping Mall on Cermak Road in Broadview, or online at buildersupplyoutlet.com.
Quality and savings are what you get at Builder Supply Outlet.
Did you know almost 40% of automobile recalls go unrepaired? That's not safe. Check drivechicago.com to see if your car has an open recall. Then no matter where you bought it, schedule an appointment with a new car dealer for a free repair. Don't wait. Do it today.
My name is David Hochberg, and I hope everyone is safe and healthy. Today, meet Beth, airline executive and mother of a medically challenged daughter. Beth was finalizing her refinance when the pandemic hit in mid-March and called to cancel her loan because she thought she was going to be furloughed. I calmly explained to Beth why canceling her loan wasn't in her financial best interest and helped Beth restructure her loan to cover 2 months of mortgage payments and reload her escrow account. Beth was against increasing her loan amount when we started the loan, but was grateful of my suggestion. Financing 2 months worth of mortgage payments along with the escrow refund from the current lender generated over $15,000 Beth desperately needed to support her daughter. If you'd like to see if Team Hochberg can restructure your mortgage to ease the economic challenges caused by the coronavirus, like we helped Beth, please call 855-56-DAVID or visit 56david.com. That number again, 855-563-2843 or visit 56david.com. Tune in to Home Sweet Home Chicago, hosted by me, Saturdays at 10 a.m. Homeside Financial, Equal Housing Lender, NMLS 112-4061.
Serving the great Midwest from Chicago, this is WGN at AM 720 on your radio and on smart devices anywhere just by saying play WGN Radio on TuneIn.
WGN Chicago.
A Nexstar Media Group station.
72 degrees at 5 o'clock. Good afternoon. I'm Kim Gordon. The news is sponsored by Grandview Homes. Illinois Republicans calling for Phase 4 to be moved up.
No more Confederate flags allowed at NASCAR events. That announcement made earlier today.
And in business, Starbucks is going to grab and go. We'll explain coming up. WGN Traffic, here's Lauren Lapka.
And this report is sponsored by AP Info. There's a vehicle fire northbound on the Tri-State on the left shoulder near Route 176. Inbound Kennedy, just a bit slow. It's 20 minutes from O'Hare, also 20 back out. Both sides of the Eisenhower between 390 and the Circle are a half hour. Up on Stevenson is slow. It's a half hour to Veterans Memorial. Inbound side is looking good. Up on Dan Ryan, seeing congestion around the Skyway. It's 19 minutes to 95th. Inbound side, not a problem there. And on I-65 North, the entrance ramp at 109th is closed for road work until June 16th. Ground Game is the latest podcast from the Associated Press. Hosted by AP's Julie Pace, Ground Game discusses election strategy all through primary season. Download it wherever you get your podcasts. I'm Lauren Lapka from the IDOT Traffic Center, reminding you to drive responsibly. It really is a matter of life or death.
The news is next, but first the WGN forecast. Here's meteorologist Demetrius Ivory.
We're expecting scattered showers and thunderstorms to be possible mainly early tonight with the low temperature down to 60. Tomorrow, sunshine comes our way. Thursday's high temperature will be in the upper 70s and low 80s. On Friday, more sunshine, lower humidities. The high temperature climbs to about 78. Saturday, we'll see sunshine during the afternoon. The high temperature 68. And Sunday, we complete a nice weekend with mostly sunny skies. High temps in the mid-70s. I'm WGN meteorologist Demetrius Ivory.
Illinois Republican senators want to push up Phase 4. Here's WGN Steve Bertrand.
Republican leader Bill Brady and the state's 18 other Republican senators are urging the governor to push Phase 4's opening up to Friday. That's a couple of weeks earlier than the governor's guidelines. The senators say business owners are frustrated by watching thousands protest in the streets while they're unable to reopen. But it's not playing with the governor. He says moving too quickly is in conflict with the science behind the virus. Steve Bertrand, WGN News.
The Illinois Department of Public Health announcing today 625 new coronavirus cases and 78 additional deaths in the last 24 hours. The total number of cases now over 129,000 in Illinois. The death toll now at 6,095. Parts of Navy Pier reopened today. That includes restaurants and boats and outdoor vendors. Here's spokesperson Payal Patel.
You can walk through the entire pier. There's plenty of space. It stretches out for about a mile long into the water. So there's plenty of opportunities for physical distancing across the pier.
The Children's Museum, rides, and the Shakespeare Theater remain closed. Those visiting must wear a mask. The pier will also be monitoring the number of visitors, and they have social distancing ambassadors scattered across the pier. Starbucks is reportedly closing 400 stores as it shifts its business model in the wake of COVID-19.
Starbucks says over the next 18 months, it'll accelerate plans to shift to what it calls a more convenience-led format, focusing on drive-throughs, mobile orders, and curbside pickups. The company says it had already been planning to shift to more grab-and-go options, but that's been jump-started by COVID-19. One way the company says it plans to adjust is by expanding pickup locations, stores intended for dense metropolitan markets where customers order and pay ahead, pick up, and then continue on their way. Mark Remillard, ABC News.
Two more Atlanta police officers have been fired over an incident in which two college students were pulled from a car during a protest against police brutality. Atlanta Mayor Keisha Lance Bottoms and Police Chief Erica Shields previously announced the firing of two other officers who were involved in the incident. All of the officers face criminal charges stemming from that event. President Trump says he'll be getting back on the campaign trail soon. He told reporters that upcoming rallies are being planned in Oklahoma, Florida, Arizona, and North Carolina. The president promised an announcement soon about relocating the Republican National Convention to another city other than Charlotte. Democratic Governor Roy Cooper has refused to guarantee Republicans can hold a full-fledged convention due to the pandemic. The Anti-Cruelty Society held a pop-up pet food giveaway in East Garfield Park today. Spokesperson Lydia Kropitsky.
Our goal at the Anti-Cruelty Society is to keep pets and people together. We realize that pets are a really important part of having a happy, healthy home. And so we want to do everything we can to keep the human-animal bond intact.
She says the pop-up started during the pandemic and they plan to keep it going. Over 7 pallets of pet food was distributed. And now WGN Sports, here's Andy Mazur.
NASCAR will not be waving the Confederate flag anymore. It's been banned from all races and properties as of today. The move comes 2 days after NASCAR's only black driver said there was no place for the flag in the sport. Bubba Wallace calls it a symbol of slavery and racism. He'll be racing tonight in Virginia in a car honoring Black Lives Matter. The sounds of skates were on the ice today as several Blackhawks returned to the Fifth Third Arena for voluntary workouts as the NHL opened phase two of the return to play plan this week.